Hello, how are you? It's been amazing, hasn't it? Really amazing. I've just been blown away by the whole thing. The adult speakers, the activities, especially the students. And there's been one theme that I think has been running through this entire conference, and that's the use of technology. And I don't know where you stand in terms of your enjoyment of technology. Some of us love it, others of us don't. But I think one thing that we can all agree on is that technology is here to stay. And I believe that in a world that is driven by the ongoing use of technology, if we're going to help students to be prepared to thrive in that world, we need to teach them new things about technology every single day. When I was 5, I learned how to play chess. And I needed someone to play against, so I taught my brother, who was 3. It's an experience. When you're playing against an adult and you take their queen, there's a certain level of unhappiness. But when you take the queen of a 3-year-old, it's an event. And my brother and I eventually got into a routine. It would start with a chess match, then it would progress to a wrestling match, and it would culminate in timeout. We were both sent to our rooms. My parents were looking for a solution, and they thought, maybe if we just give them some boxing gloves and some pads and let them go at it for a while, they can get it out of their system. I'm just kidding. I felt everyone's heart just sort of drop to the floor. Actually, chess boxing hadn't been invented yet. It's a real thing. I don't know if you've heard of it, but they put people in a ring, and they have them box for a little while. And then after they've been beat up, they sit down to play chess, and they try to make these strategic moves. And I've never played it, but as a chess player, I would have to imagine that the boxing part wouldn't be particularly helpful for the chess part and the short-term memory loss. And you know, I haven't played it, but as a chess player, I would have to say that I think the boxing part wouldn't be particularly helpful for the chess part and the short-term memory loss that might result. Eventually, my parents decided that the solution would be to put Brian and I together on a team where we played against the computer. And not only did that sort of put the wrestling to an end, but the other thing that that enabled us to do is to have an experience where we saw what it was like to see how computers think. And when you're playing against a human being in chess, you can set traps, you can try to look further than they look, and you can also try to use things that you've memorized in your games. None of those things work when you're playing against a machine. We quickly realized that in order to beat a machine, the one advantage that we had as human beings was creativity. And the thing that's great about that is in a world where machines continue to add value to our lives by taking some jobs that used to be done by human beings, the thing that's great is that human creativity can never be automated. And I believe that every child is born with this marvelous gift of human creativity, and that it's our job as adults to help them to nurture and develop that gift into skill. And if we do that, then students will be prepared not only to use technology in a way that we can't even dream of at this point, but it will also ensure that they won't be replaced by technology as it continues to take jobs that we used to do as human beings in the past. And the other thing that I believe is that innovation is dependent on a language and an understanding on the language of that space in which we're trying to innovate. And so if we're trying to innovate in a computer science space, then it's important to know the language of computer science. As a global society, as well as here in the United States, we have a social justice issue. It's projected by the Bureau of Labor and Statistics that by the year 2020, there will be 1.4 million new jobs in computer science, 1.4 million more jobs than there were a decade prior. And it's also projected that only 0.4 million students will be prepared with the skills necessary to seize those jobs. And so what that means if this takes place, is that we'll have done a great job, hopefully developing the creative abilities of all of our students, but that only 0.4 million of them will also have learned the language of technology necessary to truly innovate in the space of computing. This means that we'll have a 1 million job gap. And this is a tremendous problem, not only for the economy, but also for the overall wellness and happiness of our society. You might be familiar with STEM, science, technology, engineering, and math. This acronym that really represents four of the most high-growth, high-demand jobs of the future. And it's under the STEM umbrella that we also have an analysis of the computing jobs and the percentage that computing jobs take within this STEM field. And it's perhaps surprisingly, perhaps unsurprisingly, interesting to note that 60% of the jobs in STEM are computer science jobs. And despite that, when we look at the percentage of students who are studying computer science within the STEM space, surprisingly, only 2% of all students in STEM-related courses of study are studying computer science. This is the reason why we have a 1 million job gap on the horizon. And further, if you look at 10 high schools in the United States, 1 in 10 of those schools has computer science as part of the educational program in some shape or form. And so, we have a responsibility as citizens in this society to help prepare students for their future by building pathways for them to learn about computer science while they're simultaneously developing their skills and creativity, to also develop a level of fluency that will enable them, should they choose to be innovative in the field of computer science, to at least have that choice. I'd like to close with a story about a high school English teacher that my brother and I both benefited from. Her name was Mrs. Dowd, and we each had her for AP English. Mrs. Dowd was a pretty phenomenal teacher because not only did she ensure that all of her students were prepared for the AP English exam, and not only did all of her students develop a love and appreciation for literature, but she was also a maverick in her use of technology in the classroom. She found ways to integrate technology to drive student learning, to make it more personalized, to help us to collaborate together, not only when we were there with her in the class, but also when we were outside of the class at home. She was ahead of her time, and she took risks to make that possible. The final 2 years of my brother's high school experience were also the final 2 years of her life. She had terminal breast cancer. And the thing that's amazing about Mrs. Dowd is that in the midst of the most intense chemotherapy treatments, she somehow always found a way back into the classroom. It was as if while she was staring death into the face, she had an even greater sense of the value of her work as an educator, and an even greater sense of the value of the legacy that she would pass on and the impact that she would make on the future that she wouldn't see, but that her students would see. Before she passed away, my brother wrote a song for her that was performed by the choir at his graduation. And she knew that it was for her. And if you can picture a group of young high school students on stage singing their hearts out to a teacher that had changed their very trajectory, the words were simple, but they sang, "Thank you for shining, for giving hope. Thank you for loving, for giving life." Mrs. Dowd made personal sacrifices. She gave hope to those students in a time where she was going through intense grief. She showed love during a time when she was in extreme anguish and pain. And she gave a new life to all the students in her classroom and exposed them to technology while her very life was slipping away. And what I'm getting at is that to introduce technology in a meaningful way, and particularly to teach students the language of technology in K-12 is really hard. But when we look at people like Mrs. Dowd, she's one of many mavericks around the world who've taken risks to introduce it and who know that they might not see the future, but that their students will. Whether you're a parent, an educator, a family member, or community member, I promise you that if you make personal sacrifices to find a way to help the students and children in your circle of influence to learn the language of technology and to prepare them for that future that we might not see, that you will not only be my hero, but you'll be their hero for the rest of their lives. And the ripple effect of the impact that you've made on their lives will continue to change the world for the rest of time. Thank you very much.